If there's one thing 2013 lesbian romance Blue is the Warmest Color really managed to communicate to its audience, it was this. That director Abdelatif Kashish is obsessed with butts. The amount of rear shots in Blue is the Warmest Color is astounding. Look, this is just a character sleeping alone in her bed. Do we need to see this at this particular angle? Does this tell us anything about the story or the character? Or perhaps does it convey more about the person behind the camera? In traditional oil paintings, women are often observed by and interacting with the men around them. But they are looking at us, the spectator. In this painting, the woman is kissing Cupid, but her body is not facing him in a way that would be natural. She's positioned towards us, because she's not there for Cupid or for herself. She is here for the spectator. So I'm literally editing this right now to censor the 500-year-old painting, and YouTube is still demonetizing us. If you want to see the uncensored version and also support the channel, please consider joining the Patreon. It's the only reason we're able to do YouTube, so I'd really appreciate it. The principal protagonist is never painted. He is the spectator in front of the picture, and he is presumed to be a man. Everything is addressed to him, but he, by definition, is a stranger with his clothes still on. This is what we usually refer to as the male gaze, and of course, since Kashish decided to tell us a tender love story via disembodied close-ups and like 10 minutes of really graphic, explicit lesbian feminists were like, sir, you may want to zip up. Your male gaze is hanging out. A couple of years after the controversy stirred up by Blue is the Warmest Color, director Park Chan-wook also decided to adapt a lesbian book written by a lesbian. However, he aimed to take a different approach, to completely avoid the male gaze altogether. The Handmaiden follows a young woman named Suki as she comes to work as a handmaiden for Lady Hideko and ends up falling in love with her. But not all is as it seems. Suki is part of an elaborate plan to steal Hideko's money. Hideko's cruel uncle is holding her fortune hostage while he organizes performances in which Hideko is forced to read from his books. Hideko must escape this terrible life to find freedom with Suki. Both of the women are lured into schemes against one another by the Count, who wants Hideko's fortune for himself, but the women turn against the men, working together to claim the money and escape. They get their happily ever after, while the Count and the creepy uncle are punished. An incredible addition to the lesbian period drama genre, The Handmaiden is a stunning, intelligent film which treats its lesbian protagonists with respect, despite the fact that it's not exactly PG rated. So how did The Handmaiden manage to avoid the criticism of the male gaze that ripped apart Blue is the Warmest Color? Let's look at Transformers as an easy example.
It squirts the fuel in so you can go faster.
I like to go faster.
When Michael Bay decides to show us Michaela in this way, all sexily posed, we don't just see it through the lens of the camera, we see it through Sam. This is how Sam looks at Michaela. The audience is presumed to be male, even when they're not. They're expected to relate to Sam, to connect with his perspective and motivations. This comes from Laura Mulvey's original theory of the male gaze from way back in the 70s. She outlined three perspectives which define the male gaze: the camera, the male protagonist, and the spectator. But The Handmaiden doesn't have an equivalent to Sam. We don't see these women through the eyes of the men. In fact, we often see the two protagonists through one another's eyes. Quite literally, Park has made sure the perspective of both the camera and the characters are the women, that the gaze is reflected between the two of them. So the film subverts both the male gaze of the camera and of the male protagonist. Mulvey's essay also heavily depends on psychoanalysis, suggesting that female characters invoke a fear of castration in male viewers. Mulvey suggests that women are sexualized in film to sort of disarm them, make them unthreatening. They're not active subjects, they're a passive object for male erotic gratification. Women's bodies are literally segmented into parts by the camera, breaking them up like close-ups on lips and feet in Blue is the Warmest Color. But Park gives us full body shots of the women, showing them as full persons rather than objectifying their parts, again, subverting Mulvey's definition of the male gaze. And castration isn't just a metaphorical theme in the film, it's also quite literal. The uncle literally threatens to castrate the Count. This is not in the book, and my co-writer Ada and I reckon Park may have actually put this in the film as a reference to Mulvey. So it seems that Park, or his co-writer, actually read and followed the theory by the numbers to subvert the male gaze. The Handmaiden is a textbook example of how to respectfully portray women. I mean, sure, at the end of the film we do kind of switch to a man's perspective, the creepy Count who tried to pedicure as he gets his own private victory, saving his penis from castration. But at the end, we close on the women, finally together, posed sexily for the camera. Oh, wait, what? Oh, you thought I was just gonna enjoy a thing for a second there, didn't you? You thought I was capable of joy. No, I'm sorry, that the scenes have been a real issue in this film. They've been sometimes praised as sexy and different, sometimes panned as gratuitous and embarrassing. The question is, despite the director's claims of subverting the male gaze, are these scenes really all that different from Blue is the Warmest Color? Or to put it another way, are these women really naked at all? Or are they nude?
To be naked is to be without disguise. To be on display is to have the surface of one's own skin, the hairs of one's own body, turned into a disguise which cannot be discarded. With their clothes off, they are as formal as with their clothes on.
Compare the posture in the final scene of The Handmaiden to Celine Sciamma's French lesbian drama, Portrait of a Lady on Fire. In this scene, for instance, Marianne is not wearing clothes, warming herself by the fire after being soaking wet. This isn't a flattering pose, it isn't performed for a spectator. In Portrait, women lounge around in casual, natural, and consequently unflattering positions. In The Handmaiden, they are posing. In the final scene, the lovers are inconveniently far away from each other to create symmetry, and their bodies are twisted unnaturally away from each other so that we can see them better. The women in both The Handmaiden and Blue is the Warmest Color have completely shaved bodies, including their armpits. Like, literally, the supposedly butch French artsy lesbian has shaved armpits. Like, what the fuck is happening? There's an illustration of Hedicourt in the Uncle's collection, but because it's based on a real historical artwork, it's not shaved. But the actress is. That's not the case for the women in Portrait of a Lady on Fire, where of course they don't shave their armpits, living in isolation on an 18th century French island. There's a distinct difference in the way these women's bodies are shown. Portrait of a Lady on Fire is really the opposite end of the spectrum from Blue is the Warmest Color. The director, Sciamma, has called Portrait a manifesto on the gaze. It is a film about the process of looking and creation. The artist is hired to paint Eloise for her future husband, but Eloise doesn't want that, and she refuses to pose. The first painting, created without her knowledge, is a disaster and doesn't look much like Eloise. Eventually, the two women become intimate and begin to work together. The second painting is not created behind Eloise's back, it's a collaboration. Eloise is not just the subject of the painting, she is a co-creator. Is this the female gaze? A lot of people have speculated as to whether there is such a thing. Part of Joey Soloway's concept of the female gaze involves a returned gaze.
I see you. Seeing me. I don't want to be the object any longer. I would like to be the subject.
According to Berger, there is a small number of early European oil paintings which are exceptions to the gaze. Sometimes the intimacy can be seen between the subject and the painter.
These paintings are as personal as love poems, and their character is quite distinctive.
The way the painter has painted her includes her will and her intentions in the very structure of the image, in the very expression of her body and her face. And this is what we get from Portrait of a Lady on Fire, both from the narrative and in a meta sense. Adèle Haenel, who plays Eloise, is the former partner of the director, Sciamma. The film is an exploration of the power the artist wields over the people they portray, and on resisting that power. In one scene, Eloise poses for a portrait, and there is a mirror covering a part of her body. Her body is not there to be objectified for a man, it literally returns the gaze and reflects the artist. In the opening scene, the artist is the one posing for her students, but she is not passive, she is teaching them how to look. The creative collaboration between the director and the actresses in the film echoes the collaboration of the characters. There is no spectator and object, they are both spectator and subject. All of these kinds of scenes in Portrait have a purpose and are carefully thought out, but what's the purpose of similar scenes in Blue is the Warmest Color and The Handmaiden? Bisexual director Desiree Akhavan described Blue is the Warmest Color as a bullshit piece of bank fodder. It felt like it was using the scenes as the answer to the ultimate question that men have about lesbians. How do they without a You didn't get intimacy, you were just observing that scene from a really cold, distant point of view, and that felt insulting to me. Like, what is the point of scenes in film? Can they be done well? Can they be meaningful? Or are they just there for our titillation? In Akhavan's own work, scenes always serve a function. They reveal something about the characters. They're different at the end of the scene than they were at the start. Something has changed. You know, like every other scene, they serve a narrative purpose. Because sex itself can be a complicated experience, full of passion and insecurity and newness and fear and joy. It is intimacy, whether between strangers or old lovers. When it came to filming a sex scene in The Miseducation of Cameron Post, director Akhavan made an interesting choice. She and the rest of the crew left the set. She didn't even direct the scene. She let the actresses rehearse and develop it on their own. And the only person on set during the filming was the director of photography holding the camera. And what they came up with really worked. Akhavan said she got chills when she first watched the scene. But there's nothing graphic in it. It's in a dark space, they're clothed. And of course, these scenes don't have to be this tame to avoid the male gaze. Akhavan directed and starred in several more revealing ones, which still work because they focus on the relationship between the characters or change something for the protagonist. So in Park's attempt to subvert the male gaze in The Handmaiden, do these scenes actually serve that goal? A major theme of the story is Hideko's abuse at the hands of her uncle, who forced her to perform for men. In this case, a quite literal male gaze, with men actually looking at her, gazing at her. These scenes are designed to literally show what male gaze is, and in a very palpable manner, it shows you what the violence of gaze can do. Even if Hideko was wearing layers of kimono, it doesn't matter. She might as well have been exposed in front of those men. So rather than touching her, these men are meters away from the stage where she's giving the reading. But in these reading sessions, they might as well have been gang-raping her. He tells us that these men are creepy and gross, and Suki ragefully tears apart the uncle's book collection when she finds out what he's been doing to Hideko. And yet, in the final scene, Suki and Hideko reenact one of those stories. The room they're in mirrors the stage on which Hideko was performing for the men. The women don't choose the comfy bed, which is also in the room. Instead, they are on this small little awkward love seat, their bodies posed and exposed for us. These poses are not for them, and therefore the spectator. Some critics have tried to justify this scene by saying, it's okay, the audience is gone, the women have escaped and are alone. But that seems like a very short-sighted interpretation, because there is still an audience. It's us, sitting in front of the screen. We, the spectator, are cast in the role of the creepy men watching the women, objectifying them, turning their private love into a spectacle, with Park as the creepy uncle orchestrating it for us. How meaningful was the destruction of the uncle's books if we still get to enjoy the content we're told we should abhor? The way the final scenes of this film read are as speaking to that male audience. They challenge him, saying, "You have now become the spectator, you dirty perv." And the scene is key to understanding the film. Park has read Mulvey and is using her theory to say, "You've rooted for the heroines and you've condemned the pervy uncle, but aren't you just like him, dear male viewer?" Which, it's very clever, right? And in fact, Blue is the Warmest Color has a similar self-awareness. The film opens with a scene in class where a girl is reading from the book La Vie de Marianne in a clear nod to the French title of the film, La Vie d'Adèle. The quote she's reading says, "I am a woman, I tell my story," but she gets interrupted by a male teacher telling her how to read it. This is the first scene very blatantly telling us, look at this girl reading a story written by a man and having her performance dictated by a man. There are messages like this repeated throughout the film. And of course, there is the whole main story about a teenage girl who falls in love with an older artist who paints her and who turns nasty as soon as she fails to fit the idealized image that has endowed her with artistic value. Kashish is not just a misogynist with abusive on-set practices, he's self-aware about it. Blue and The Handmaiden are both male directors' musings on their own sexism and their audience's sexism, which is all terribly interesting and clever, but does being aware of your own male gaze undermine it? Does sexualizing women on screen in the name of questioning sexualizing women on screen change the status quo in any way? In the book The Handmaiden was based on, and in the BBC adaptation, which was directed by a woman, Maud's gloves are an important symbol. They're literally on the cover of the book. Maud wears gloves because her uncle won't let her touch his books without them. You know, he's scared that contact with a real woman would ruin his precious, idealized portrayals of women.
Not a cover is to be touched or a leaf to be turned without them, do you understand?
He's reinforced the gloves rule so fiercely since Maud was a child that she's now traumatized and never takes them off, including when she's sleeping. That's why this scene in which the awful count tries to remove them feels so invasive that my first instinct is to have to censor it for YouTube. This is a violent gesture. There is nothing to censor, but the emotional impact is immense. And then on the other hand, when Sue takes the gloves off and Maud lets her, it's such an intimate moment and so telling of the love and trust between the women. It's very impactful, more impactful in my opinion, than Park's interpretation. In fact, in Park's version, the meaning behind the gloves is kind of obscured. They seem like they could just be a fashion accessory. Hideko isn't even wearing them the first time she hooks up with Suki. Kashish has said he had to include the scenes in Blue is the Warmest Color because they convey the passion of the girls' relationship. It's so fascinating that these artsy directors who put so much thought and symbolism into their films can't think of a way of portraying lesbian intimacy that isn't just a replica of what you'd find on Hub, but oh, you know what? They're going to be self-aware about it, so it's totally cool. And that's all the more fascinating because this is a huge theme of the book The Handmaiden is based on. The book was written by a lesbian and interpreted to be the author's response to the feminist discourse on pornography. In the book, this last scene doesn't happen at all. The women aren't running away to a different country. Instead, Maud has inherited the house and has become a writer. We don't get to read her work, but she reads it to Sue. Maud is no longer a passive performer reading books written by men to a male audience. Instead, she is now writing her own stories. And in the last scene of the book, she reads them to her lover. These are lesbian stories by a lesbian for a lesbian audience. Maud and Sue reappropriate the uncle's work for themselves, for a lesbian sexuality. But in the film, that reappropriation doesn't ever happen. Rather, another type of reappropriation is performed for us. They don't create their own. They perform an existing work for us. Maybe Park was most honest about it when he said that despite all this male gaze discourse, at the end of the day, he just had to do what he wanted to do. Mulvey's original male gaze theory was not written for a world in which big budget sexy lesbian films exist, and was written with a little too much faith in psychoanalytics, which has been criticized both for being deeply patriarchal and not particularly scientific. Her male gaze is a dated theory which hasn't really adapted to modern cinema. But even so, by the end of The Handmaiden, the protagonist is now the man, and he wins a small battle against castration, which represents fear of feminine. The spectator is masculine, and the camera has adopted a male gaze. In the book, the Count doesn't play such a big role. He's not the one who comes up with the money-making scheme. He's just a pawn in a much bigger plan orchestrated by Sue's adoptive mother. She's the one who chooses a tragic death, and she's not just a scheming villain. Her story is a comment on the lengths women have to go to in a patriarchal society to ensure a better life for their daughters. The last third of the book still centers women. This is a women's story. Because the adoptive mother's grand plan has been cut from The Handmaiden, we never learn the final twist, that the girls were born on the same day, swapped as babies, and that they each get half the inheritance. Park said that the final scene in his film is a ritual, representing how the women have overcome the differences of their class, age, and nationality, and created an equal relationship. But he cut all the stuff that actually made them materially equal in the book, about their age, the shared inheritance. It's all gone, because he was more interested in the men's stories, and this shit right here. He claims this scene has a narrative function, despite the fact that he removed everything that could really give it a narrative function. In The Handmaiden, the climax of the story is about men. This might not be something a lesbian audience would be especially interested in watching, but this film wasn't made for lesbians. This film is made for men, and any lesbian watching is caught up in the meta-narrative. She's also asked, "Why do you want to see a raunchy lesbian film, you creep?" Because the meta-narrative only works with a male spectator. The camera is male, the spectator is expected to be male. Provocative sexual content has, since the beginning of cinema, also been a great marketing strategy. In an age where it seems like the only films that sell theater tickets are CGI franchises, how can foreign art films make any money at all? Well, being so scandalous and sexy that everyone's talking about them sure doesn't hurt. Park would wax poetic about how his film is breaking taboos, starting conversations about homosexuality. But like, if he cared so much about lesbians, he could have collaborated with actual lesbian filmmakers. He wasn't raising awareness about lesbians, he was raising awareness about his sexy new thriller, which you should buy a ticket to go see. Is it really appropriate to take a lesbian's book about liberating lesbian love from the male gaze and turn it into a philosophical musing between men? How is the audience supposed to believe the textual escape of these heroines when their efforts are undermined by the structural message of the film? The Handmaiden is a beautiful film in many ways, and the point of this video is not to say that it's bad or that you shouldn't enjoy it, but rather to explore why, despite Park's stated intentions, does it still feel so uncomfortably male gazey? Apparently, while filming these scenes, Park had all of the male crew leave the set, including himself, and just had women on the set for the shoot. But unlike Desiree Akhavan, who took herself completely out of the equation, Park actually remotely directed the scene from outside. And I think that's such a funny metaphor for his use of the male gaze in this film. The invisible spectator, ever present. The original uncensored extended version of this video is available on Patreon. Patreon is really the only reason that Ada and I are able to produce video essays at all. Without it, we'd be completely screwed, so I'd really appreciate any new patrons. There are also a few other Patreon exclusive videos to check out too. Thank you so much to all the amazing patrons that support this channel, and a special thank you to Corbin Found, Fluffy Bunny Boo, Gamer Guy J, Gwenda Euphoria, Helena Varvarousis, Joe Liss, Juliana Backer, Machina X Domina, Mia Nilo, Matheta, Miren McLean, Nathan Temekel, Nina Vengberg, Non Anonymous, Norberto Ochoa, Selenia Latavara, Siobhan, Sophie, Stephen Wallace, Talia Parkinson, Abigail Eckstein, Aaron, AJ Mango, Alice, Alice Lovell, Alina Vera, Amelia D, Angela, Anya Steven, Arden, Artemix, Avriota, B, Ben Hengst, Beslaf, Beth, Byroni, Break Every Yoke, Bump Girl, Kane Friedman, Katrina Lexi, Charis Edwards, Chloe Strange, CJ Gibson, Claire, Dana Lynn, Deanna McMillan, Devon As Usual, Dropout Ninja, Eden Ladley, Erie Enby, Elsie Astro, Amelia and Lucy, Emma Bales, Emery James Fairgreave, Erica Nisland, Eve Griffith, Faye Crossroads, Fancy Angles, Fawn, Gabriella Day, Gavin Salmon, Gerald Brenter, Ghost and You Might Die, Ginger, Grace Robertson, Grisala Farben, Guillaume Perez, Hackneyed Edits, Hertzville, Jackie Queen of Thieves, Jam Kwasowski, Jennifer Fronister, Gillian D, Joe McManus, Jules Inkwell, Julio Leote, Julio Mendez, Julius Sawin, Juniper Lopez, Kale, Kaleidoscopic, Katharina Glomb, Katie B, Katie Ballinger, Katya, Kaysera, Kyle Denley, Lee Hedstrom, Lindsay Mercer, Liron E, Lisa Spitalovitz, Lumpy Llama, Marla, Math Class Warfare, Maxim Shulin, McKinning Wood, Megan Fauci, Metavor, Mo, Moogsy, Moomin Puppet, Moshe Gordon Radian, Murmai Salil, Neve, Nico, Nick Snary, Nina, Noe, Nullbuild, Ophelia, Os Donnelly, Ossian Matthew, Pani Lin, Pseudo Pac-Man, Public L, Queer Aesthetic, Rochelle, Radical Planning, Rebecca Peacock, Reese Enghart, River Haddocock, Rock the Shell, Sarah Buchelman, Sarah R, Shockstopia, Sean, She Algorithm, Shiro the Nerd, Sylvia, Simon Patience, Sithvich, Summertime Killer, Susie S, Sveepal the Transboy Valkyrie, Tia Till, Tim Anderson, Tina Gigya, Tiny Wooden Tree, Tom Harrison, Troy Zaire, Verlux, Vicious Panda, Vince Whittaker, Wandering Sock, Wards, Will O'Connor, Jonathan Zunger, and Yuli Themstedt.